Love. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and he who loves is born of God and knows God. I want to start with a story today from a book called The Christian Leader by Don Ratzlaff. He retells a story Vernon Grounds came across in Ernest Gordon's wonderful book, Miracle on the River Kwai. Scottish soldiers forced by their Japanese captors to labor on a jungle railroad had degenerated to barbarous behavior. But one afternoon something happened. A shovel was missing. The officer in charge became enraged. He demanded that the missing shovel be produced or else. When nobody in the squadron budged, the officer got his gun and threatened to kill them on the spot. It was obvious the officer meant what he said. Then finally, one man stepped forward. The officer put away his gun, picked up the shovel, and beat the man to death. When it was over, the survivors picked up the bloody corpse and carried it with them to the second tool check. This time, no shovel was missing. Indeed, there had been a miscount at the first checkpoint. The word spread like wildfire throughout the whole camp. An innocent man had been willing to die to save the others. The incident had a profound effect. For the first time, the men began to treat each other like brothers. When the victorious allies swept in, the survivors, looking like human skeletons, lined up in front of their captors and instead of attacking them, said, "No more hatred, no more killing. Now what we need is forgiveness." Sacrificial love has transforming power, real transforming power, when it's manifest in concrete action in history. John is writing to a community which is struggling because there have been some people who got involved in some bad theology. We've mentioned that it's got a form that is sometimes called by theologians docetism. It involves thinking that somehow Jesus' humanity is not quite full humanity in the sense in which we're intended to think of it. He's God, but he only seems to be human. He appears to be human. And they've been in the community, and they've been teaching, and they've been drawing people away from the faith. In one point, John says, they were with us, but they've left from us because they were not of us. So he's got a community where there have been these ideas sown that are not Christian ideas, and it's kind of thrown the community off. And the concern he has, we've said this repeatedly, is to give his community assurance. This is written, he says in chapter 5, so that you might know that you have eternal life. And today, what we get to is a section which I think is properly outlined or called in praise of love or walking in love. It's all about love and the way that love is a source of assurance that one has eternal life. And it's a fascinating section, and I want you to look at your text beginning at verse 7 of chapter 4, and I'm going to break it down into two parts. First, verses 7 through 12, which you could call in praise of love or a hymn to love. Here's F.F. Bruce in his commentary. "The love which the New Testament enjoins is a consuming passion for the well-being of others. And this love has its wellspring in God." What's remarkable about 1 John, even though it's so short, is that love is an enormous emphasis in the letter. This is now the third time in this short letter already, we're only in chapter 4, remember, that John has elaborated on the theme of love. If you're taking notes, chapter 2, verses 7 through 11, and chapter 3, verses 11 to 18, were two others. John uses the word, how about this, 26 times in this letter. And in this chapter, chapter 4, it appears 12 times. 12 times in this one chapter. The central idea that John is after is to know the love of God is to manifest his love. This is the key mark of what it means to be a Christian, not chasing after or claiming some special knowledge or gnosis about the things of God. This is what the false teachers were clearly doing. And it created an environment where people lost confidence and started thinking incorrectly about their faith. And what John is saying is, it isn't by special spiritual experiences or special knowledge that you can have assurance. It's through the manifestation of love in your life, because when you live out and act as a Christian, it shows that indeed you are as a Christian. All right, look at your text and let me make a few observations about verses 7 through 12. First, it is striking, in the Greek in particular, how this passage begins, and I want to read it to you. Agapetoi agapomen. I don't know if you can hear that. Agapetoi agapomen. Only two Greek words, and you can hear agape twice. So in my translation, the Revised Standard that I've got here, beloved, let us love one another. It's even stronger than that. It's beloved love. What's amazing is John starts this passage by demonstrating his love for his readers and by demonstrating one of the ways that love works in a practical sense in our lives. Language matters. Beloved, he says in verse 7, and then look at your text again in verse 11, beloved. Part of love is using these words and meaning it, right? Many of you may remember this scene in Fiddler on the Roof when there's a discussion about, do you love me? And the response is, well, I do this and I do this and do this. And yes, wait, yes, but do you love me? Well, I do this and I do this and I do this. It's a big source of collision. It's not that the action doesn't matter, but there needs to be speaking. We're created as verbal creatures. We're created through the Word of God, and we are people who live through and work with words. And John is talking about love at the very outset, and he says, beloved. It's a great way to refer to the church. Brothers and sisters is one of the phrases that I like to use. It's very important to try to think of the church as a family. I wonder if you think about the people maybe in your home group, if you're listening in a home group or whatever church, but I wonder if you think of your brothers and sisters in your own church family as beloved, with a sense of preciousness that that word implies. He also says, one of the more famous statements in the New Testament at the end of verse 8, God is love. And that's one of those tricky things where we have to be careful to think through what John's intention is and to make sure to read this statement in the full context of the paragraph in which it appears. David Jackman says this, John is not identifying a quality which God possesses. He is making a statement about the essence of God's being. It is not simply that God loves, which of course is true, but that's not what John is saying. It is that he is love. There are in the New Testament three other statements, only three, where the A equals B kind of sentence is used in reference to God. That is to say, God is, and then a noun. God is spirit, John 4. God is light, 1 John chapter 1, that's verse 5. And in Hebrews 12, a really amazing image, God is a consuming fire. Now, the first thing that we want to note about this is, it's very important that you note and think this through at the level of the reversibility of these kind of affirmations, right? If it's true, as it is, that God is light, it's not true that light is God. One of the things that this sentence in the New Testament is used for is a lot of very slippery and sometimes poor thinking and theology about love, right? As if love is God. So you have, for example, an unnamed Episcopal seminary teacher saying, I want to bless love wherever I find it. As if when you look at a situation and evaluate if people have what you think are really lovely feelings, then that's something that needs to be blessed. It doesn't follow that because God is love, love is God. That's not what John is saying. These statements are not reversible. Consuming fire isn't God. Light isn't God. And Spirit isn't God, but God is love, God is spirit, God is light, and God is consuming fire. Are you with me so far? All right, and the other thing is, in every example where these kind of affirmations are made, it's always something that is then described. And in this passage, it's described wonderfully. In this is love, verse 10, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be a propitiation, I think is the right way to translate that word, for our sins, right? So what does John do? when he's talking about love. He states it as one of the key essences of the character of God, and then he immediately goes to the cross. He immediately goes to the cross. C.E. Goodman of Hallmark greeting cards wrote a slogan in 1944 that you may know: when you care enough to send the very best. It's quite effective. Ever since, the motto has been used to sell all sorts of greeting cards. And the whole idea that John's trying to get us to understand is, when we look at Jesus Christ, we know that God cared enough to send the very best. You have to really let that sink in. You know, how many of us, when we give anything to anybody, immediately start and give up the very best? Usually that's not what we do. If somebody asks for, you know, a rummage sale or something, or a donation, we usually give, you know, from the very edge, right? But we're not talking about that. We're talking about the opposite of that. This is God's only begotten Son whom he sent. Bishop Charles Gore in the 19th century said that this is the hardest of all things to believe. Interesting that a Christian theologian of his stature would say that. I brought the quote from his book, and I want to read it to you. "There are many who certainly have the will to believe," Gore says, "but who find the belief that God is love very difficult. The days seem to them far off when it was possible with any plausibility to contrast the simple doctrine that God is love with the elaborate and difficult dogmas of the church. For they feel that it is only the dogmas that Jesus Christ is God and his mind is God's mind, and that God, the God of nature, really vindicated him by raising him from the dead, that do in fact sustain their tottering faith and hope in God." Do you see what he's saying? It's not a frivolous assertion, and it's not an assertion that you can kind of grasp hold of and leave like a piece of string. It's an absolutely central belief. When you stand up and say the creed, you can think of it that way. I believe that God is love. In the spite of all the suffering that you see, of all the things that you can't explain, of all the challenges in your life, of all the incredible medical ailments that people have to wrestle with, and we could go on and on and on. This stands out. Now, here's the key point. What Gore is saying is profound. He's saying the way that God is love is known is not, this is crucial, not from our ideas of love in to God. It's from God and the cross of Jesus Christ out. God defines what love looks like. You and I actually know very little about real love. But God is the one who is love and who manifests love on the cross. So we start at the Triduum, so-called, the great 3 days, Good Friday, Holy Saturday, and Easter. That's what love looks like in history. Love in history sacrifices everything, the very best. That one man in that story I began with, who let himself be killed in front of all the others with a shovel, who gave his life, galvanized an entire community. He gave everything. He gave the very best. And God sent his only Son. He gave the very best. So when we say God is love, it's got to get very tangible and very cross-centered and very Christ-centered very quickly, or we're in danger of going off the rails. Just in passing, a couple of applications, if I might. You know Galatians 5, the fruit of the Spirit is. Just remember, because it's always good to remember these things, that the first one is love, right? It's a long list. It's an impressive list. And 1 Corinthians 13, it's read at weddings. Sometimes it's read too often. But it's a beautiful passage, and it's in the New Testament for a reason. If I do all these things, Paul says, and I have not love, I'm like a clanging gong. It's all meaningless without love. Love is incredibly important, the most important thing. So what do we learn about love? We learn that love is the fruit of the Spirit in the community, and that John wants to see his community manifest the love because they know that God loved them. Look at verse 11. If God so loved us, we ought to love one another. It's not an external imposition. It's an internal reality that's grasped and then moves out. When I look at the cross and I know how much God loved me because he sent the very best, with that kind of love in my heart, then I move out to others. And it compels me inwardly and then out to do that. And the two things that I just want to say to you are, make sure to note both of the manifestations of love in this passage. Love is something that you say, and love is something that you do. That seems really simple. It's not. Love is something that you say. There's a book that was popular a good while back now called The Friendship Factor. It's a book about how to form friends, and it's got some basic principles. Here's one of the principles. You actually give compliments and mean them. Imagine. That is to say, if you say something that builds somebody up, that makes you more likely to be the kind of person that will develop friendships. Now that's really straightforward, but you would be amazed at how many people don't do that. Think of Jesus' ministry. Think of how many people were in positions of nearly total hopelessness who came to him, and he is speaking words of life. Go wash in the pool of Siloam, he says to the man born blind. You know, he's given him something to do. The guy's been transfixed. He can't see anything. He clearly sees that the guy has dignity and worth and a call of God. And he says, go. Not only does nobody say go, nobody even talks to this guy. And Jesus speaks a word of affirmation. Jesus is constantly speaking words of love. Don't forget this, all the way up to the end. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. All the way to the end. Not simply doing it, but saying it. Don't underestimate the importance of saying it. And one last point just on this, the verbal side, and that is, I know we're in the age of email, but notes matter. My father was a teacher for a long time, and he used to basically have 2 hands worth of thank you notes. They were incredibly precious to him because he got so few. George Patton got very few letters from soldiers that left his charge that thanked him. But when he did, they meant an enormous amount. So he says, so don't forget to say it, and don't forget to say it in writing. The other thing, of course, is love is something that you do. Now, I'm in a particular week at a particular time at the parish where I serve at Christ St. Paul's. And just one example of this, it's kind of fun. I was talking to the rector here, Craig Barrett, my coworker. And when I called up, his wife answered his cell phone. I don't know if you've ever had that experience with a friend or not, but I wasn't expecting it. You know, I called Craig's cell phone. I got his wife, Nancy. And she said, Craig's not here, but he'll be right back. He went over to get me a banana. So the rector was on his way from the rectory over to church to get his wife a banana. And when I finally got a hold of Craig, I said, way to go, guy, serving your wife. I have no idea why she wants a banana, but if she wants a banana, you get her a banana, right? But it's a simple thing, and yet it's not a simple thing. It's lovely, right? That's what marriage is all about. She needs a banana. She, for whatever reason, couldn't or wouldn't or whatever get up and get one. He knew where one was. He went and got it. That just happened. That's what love looks like in action. It's the little things that you do like that, that you take the time to say, I appreciate that. Thank you for doing that. The other story I wanted to tell you is about one of the doctors that I have frequent association with. He got transferred, he works in ER, from a more private hospital to the VA. And we were talking. And I asked him the question, what is the biggest difference? Because they're different environments, right? A VA hospital and a private hospital, they don't feel the same, they don't look the same, the kind of milieu is not the same. His answer was unforgettable. He said, Kendall, they're courteous and they say thank you. He said, in most of the hospital ERs where I work, people expect care. They demand care. They don't say thank you. They don't seem to appreciate it. He said, every single person I take care of at the VA says thanks. Military culture does it again. But the point is, it's inculcated in that culture because it matters. Okay, so much for in praise of love, verses 7 to 12. Now, it's not just that it manifests itself in love, but it manifests itself in truth. Perfect love and sound doctrine is the heading that I've given for the next section, verses 13 to 21. Look at your text and let's think about this section. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he's given us of his own Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son as Savior of the world. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him and he in God. Here's F.F. Bruce again. The Spirit imparts God's love, but the Spirit also imparts God's truth. The Spirit of love is the Spirit of truth, right? The key idea of this passage, missed by a lot of people who make comments on it and who preached on it, that I took a look at in the past couple of weeks, is the Spirit. The Spirit is powerfully present all the way through. The indwelling Spirit of God, verse 12, at the end of the previous section we were looking at, abides in the people of God. God abides in us. God comes and makes his home with us in and through his Spirit, right? That's what John 16 promises. We will come and make our home. That's what the Holy Spirit does. He is God in us, right? Not God beyond us, the Father, not God alongside us, the Son, but God in us. God abides in us by the Spirit. And then verse 13, look at what it says. We abide in him and he in us. There's that indwelling Spirit again. And then in verse 15, whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him and he is in God. All these are implicit references to the manifestation, the ministry, and the person of the Holy Spirit. And then just in case we missed it, the third time in this paragraph and the fourth time in these two paragraphs, verse 16. So we know and believe the love God has for us. God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him. The indwelling work of the Holy Spirit. What this passage is all about is right belief. Remember, we talked about this. John has readers who are struggling with a sense of confidence and a need for assurance. And John's answer is a threefold stool. It's what you believe, it's how you live, and it's the Spirit of God in you manifesting the work of the Spirit in your life. It's those three things that are the source of your assurance. Do you know that you're a Christian is an important and also a hard question to answer. And one of the ways you got to answer it is you got to believe correct things about God. It's not random, our faith. It's got specificity. That's why we confess the Nicene Creed in worship every week. So when it says, because he's given us of his own Spirit, and then goes right away to talk about doctrine, the Father sending the Son, it's because this false teaching is mucking around the community, and it's got to have specificity. You can't go away from the truth into these false ideas. The Spirit of God is the Spirit of truth. It leads you in the right way. So the assurance that John wants his readers to have involves the indwelling Spirit of God. And one of the ways the Spirit of God manifests itself is a concern for truth. We're back to the issue of discernment that we talked about at the beginning of John 4, right? Don't believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are of God. What does he say? He says, you have to believe that Jesus is the Son of God, right? So one of the things that you've got to do if you're worried about whether somebody is spiritually sound is to ask them questions about what they believe. That's not the only thing, but that's one of the things. And we have to learn as Christians to be willing to test things doctrinally. We have to be able to say, okay, here comes a teaching. I might read this book, but we don't just read every book. We read books and we say, now, is this a sound book? Should I read this author? Should I listen to this teacher, you know, on a podcast, on a sermon? A story about testing the spirits and the Spirit of truth. I really like this one. It's from one of the writers who works in the area of Christian ministry a lot. And part of the reason I like it is it's about his young son. Okay, so his family has a rigmarole whereby they have a set-up test whereby if anybody comes to the door or to them on behalf of their parents for whatever reason, it's the set-up with a possible stranger mode, they set up a family code, right? So his father of this young boy is packing up after a concert and they're too busy and it's taking too long, so they send a woman who's part of the community to pick up the children from the home they were staying in. They dropped them off. But the children didn't know the woman, right? So in comes this signal. I told her to give our son our secret family code word so that our son would know that she was authorized to pick him up. You got the idea? So in this family, you can't just show up if they don't know who you are and say, hi, I'm here because your parents sent me to pick you up or to take you to the store. You have to know the secret code. That's the way they set it up. So he's working at the concert, and he says, a little later, I received a phone call. His son, age 6, refused to leave because the woman hadn't given the right code. The father had messed up. He said the code word was dinosaur monster. And the father was horrified to be informed by his son, who was correct, that the word is dinosaur. The reason she'd muffed up is she'd been misinformed. Are you sure? The dad says to his 6-year-old son. I was certain it was dinosaur monster. I'm sure, said his son confidently. Well, okay, son, you're probably right. But anyway, it's okay for you to come back to church with that lady. There was silence on the other end of the line. And his 6-year-old son said, who is this? It's me, your father. Now get in the car and come home. All right, he replied and hung up. And he says this, it was an odd feeling to be interrogated by my 6-year-old son. He knew the word, and even though he was given words that were very close, note, to the real thing, they weren't true. And he knew the difference. A mature Christian knows the word of God and is not easily tossed about, and I quote, with every wind of doctrine, Ephesians 4. We are to test the spirits by the word to see if they are true. Now, one last point, and then we're done. Another section about discernment was just what I said. Now I want to finish off with this sense of confidence. Verse 17, in this is love perfected in us, that we may have confidence for the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. Because the Spirit is the Spirit of truth and the Spirit of the Father, who allows us to call him Abba Father, we know that we belong to him. And one of the things that's happened in the community is they've created a two-tiered situation where there are Christians who have the special knowledge, who have the special understanding, and there are Christians who don't. And so there's a fear that they're not legitimate, they're not really saved, they're not really true Christians. And John says, if you have the Spirit, if you believe the right things, right, and if you live the right way, then you can be assured. And he wants that assurance. Do you remember what he said in chapter 3, verse 1? See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and so we are. Why does he belabor that point? It's like, my last name is Harmon, it's like me saying to my children, do you know that you guys are Harmons? I mean, why would I say something like that? Because they're not sure they're Harmons. There's some uncertainty that's been injected. You can feel the pastoral heart of John coming across in this image. In this idea, he says, don't worry about judgment. Don't be worried about being found false and to fall short. You belong to Christ. You believe the right things. You have the Spirit within you, and you're living Christian lives because the love of God that's put in you is manifest to the people of God that have come out of you. And I just remind you again, as we've hit this theme before in this series, don't underestimate the importance of Christian confidence. This is a community that has significant experience with Christ. They have significant experience with teaching, but some of them at least have been thrown off. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out all fear. We love, John says, because he first loved us, and we can have assurance. There is nothing to fear. So whenever Jesus comes back, if it is before we go from this world to the next in our own death, we have nothing to fear because the judge has come already and judged himself in our place, right? So it's not true that there are two tiers of Christians in any church. There are people who belong to Christ and there are people who don't. And if you belong to Christ, according to John's threefold test and criterion, you can have confidence no matter when Jesus comes. It's something to look forward to, not something to dread. Thank you very much.